afternoon and a very warm welcome to you. My name is Jeannie D.
And I'm Bonnie Booley.
Today is going to be an outstanding show. But now, I don't know about you, but I am completely addicted to watching the Olympic Games on TV. I mean, they are just brilliant. Now, one of the world's most decorated Olympians has literally broken the internet. And he is literally the poster child for Dick Beck at the moment. So I'm talking about Michael Phelps, who recently raced Chad Leclos, which was quite a controversial race. And I mean, have a look. He's quite an angry man over there because Chad Leclos was apparently, you know, getting in his head. And then the internet took over and it completely went viral. I don't know about you, but that man has got a seriously angry
That's
look.
That's hilarious.
He needs anger management issues. He may have to trade in his gold medal for all of that. But yeah, absolutely amazing stuff going on in the games. Now today, speaking about games, we are going to be chatting to one of the greatest referees of all time in rugby. His name is Jonathan Kaplan, and we are so honored to have him in the loft today. Now he's recently become a dad, so we're going to be celebrating with him today. And the story is so fascinating because it was via a surrogate mother, which means he got his sperm, a donor egg, and another woman who was basically the incubator. So, I mean, it's absolutely amazing. Such a beautiful story, and we're going to be learning more about that later today.
Yeah, definitely looking forward to hearing more about that. And of course, we love it when you interact with us on social media, on all the platforms. And today we ask you the question, would you carry somebody else's child, yes or no, and why? Please tweet us on our hashtag AfternoonExpress at AfternoonChat or give us a call on 083-913-3728. And I also sit down with the gardening expert, Ben Getz, a bit later, and he gives us tips on how to start your own veggie garden with your family. And speaking of gardening, it's a sea harvest in the kitchen.
Indeed. Before we get into what we're cooking in the kitchen today on Afternoon Express, don't forget on Win a Home on Afternoon Express today, we're going to be taking another look at a beautiful home. Today, we're moving our attention to Cape Town, and we take a little focus around the area of Rondebosch. There's a stunning home there that I got a chance to have a really cool tour of around. It's got this really cool nook at the top for all the kids, a TV screen, a whole bunch of speakers around. Such a fabulous home. I can't wait for you guys to see it. And then speaking of the delicious food that Bonnie was talking about, a lot's happening in the kitchen today. In fact, two amazing dishes, and one of them happens to be Italian. You and I can win.
There we go.
Although not in that kitchen segment. It's so a bit sad.
Shame. We can have some of it later on.
Cool. No what are problem. We making?
So to start off with, I'm going to make an Italian one-pot wonder. Mm. It's full of seafood, full of aromatic flavors, everything that an Italian dish should have.
Okay, amazing. And then also we're going to be making something else on the show today, which is very, very exciting. We're going to be making a
Tres leches, cake, pudding, jar, a little amazing dish, I can't wait. And that's a little Mexican, a little Spanish in there. Ooh. Italian, a little Spanish, you know?
I think, do they like each other? I'm not too sure.
I mean, Stone Pedro, hey, I don't know.
It works and it's right here on Afternoon Express. You're going to get all the recipes and the details is on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. But also don't forget, we mentioned, I think yesterday on Afternoon Express, or the day before yesterday, we announced the official launch of a brand new competition coming to Afternoon Express. Joburg got their turn, now Cape Town's getting their turn. Tell us more.
So we've got two winners already.
Yay!
And the viewers have been paying attention. So what you have to do is you go onto our Facebook page, find the Hellman's post, and the trick is, again, how challenging is this? I don't think so. Come up with a signature dish featuring the world famous mayonnaise, Hellman's, of course. Mm-hmm. And then each day we're going to select the winner.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be a burger though, right?
No.
Not even, anything.
Any dish.
Okay, cool.
So we've got two winners. Three more days to go, and you have to enter, guys.
Okay.
Definitely.
And obviously, if you are one of the winners, you get to join myself and Clem as we go into a sort of burger masterclass, burger making masterclass, which will be super cool, and it's right here in Cape Town. So all the Cape Townians want to win really cool prizes, especially with the temperature in Cape Town today. I'm pretty sure you're going to want something delicious as we prepare for those summer seasons. Make sure you enter the competition, and you could be a winner. Welcome to the show. Jeannie and Bonnie are on standby with our first guest.
International rugby referee Jonathan Kaplan officiated in 13 Rugby World Cup matches, 68 tests, 107 Super Rugby matches, and 161 Currie Cup clashes before retiring at the end of 2013 season. Now, he holds the record for the most international games refereed, and recently he became a father through the help of what is called a surrogate mother. Welcome to our couch. I can't believe that you're finally on the show. It's only taken me a while to ask you.
I know, you're a very shy girl.
Yeah, I really am. Now, Jonathan, you were such an exceptional referee. Why did you get into refereeing and not playing?
I think the main reason was that I was probably a bit too small. I wasn't put together like a rugby player.
Yeah.
And I wasn't prepared to train, you know, that regime of going to gym every day and doing 14, 15, 16. So that's not really my thing.
Yeah.
But I was quite passionate about the sport. And so I decided that the refereeing angle was something I was prepared to try.
Yeah.
And as I've documented in my book, it was quite a process to get me involved. I was quite stubborn.
What is the process? How would you
I started at school, so I was just running touch for the first team. Yeah. And then my mom said, "You seem to know it all. You're better than the, you know, more
you
than
do
the referee."
Yeah,
no, no, I'm still like that. So, anyway, she said, "Look, how would you like to?" I said, "Well, if you make a call, I'm happy to give it a go." Anyway, she phoned Ellis Park as it was in those days, and she said she'd like to inquire about becoming a ref. So they said, "No, they don't accept women referees." So she said, "No, it's not for her. It's for her son. How old is he? 17. No, that's also too young." Anyway, my mom's very persuasive, and I started in '84, and I'm going to be doing my close to 1100th game on Saturday, just as it started as an amateur.
Wow, that is absolutely incredible. Yeah. You must have had quite a career, but I think there's a huge responsibility on the shoulders of a referee. I mean, I'm a huge rugby fan. I'm a bigger couch rugby fan, but I mean, I love rugby. Yeah. But I mean, how often are people going, "Oh, ref"? And I mean, it's a lot of pressure on your shoulders.
Except when
you were reffing, I suppose.
Well, it depends what kind of an animal you are, because I don't think that's my pressure.
What is your pressure?
Well, it's not running on. So initially, when I was less comfortable with the domain, I probably just needed to find my feet. So I was probably running around like a chicken without a head. As soon as I started to understand what I needed to do, then I was fine on the field. And then it wasn't about. It was more about understanding that I was a human being and forgiving myself.
Yeah.
So when I made a mistake, I hate making mistakes, but I'm a
it
human
happens,
being.
Yeah.
And so when I did, I'd prefer, you know, preferably in a low-key game, but I did make some in high-profile games, and that's what happens if you've got a career of 33 years.
Exactly. Yeah. It's quite, you've got to have quite a lot of courage of your own conviction in that position. And it's also, you've got to stand up for yourself, because it can be quite intimidating with all of those.
It's not really intimidating for me. I've never thought, I mean, maybe we're different, but I've never thought size was very important. So, you know. It wasn't that impressive for me at any stage, but it was, you know, to go to stadiums for the first time, that was a novelty, and obviously it was, you know, there were some elements of what I did that was challenging.
Yeah.
Like dealing with the media, I remember, was very difficult for me initially, because obviously they write for a parochial audience. Mm. So are we still on that? So they write for a parochial audience. So the audience is all about, their writing is all about catering for their 100,000 people who read their newspaper or the digital side of things. And I didn't understand that in the beginning. I wanted them to present something balanced, and they weren't able to do that. And then I got agitated and irritable. And once I understood the domain, then it was much easier for me.
Exactly.
I was just go out, do your business. And the main thing for me was trying to understand the dynamics of the game. And obviously, because I was involved for a long time, it was the game moved, and then I had to move with the game. Otherwise, you get stuck behind, you're reffing that same way, and the game carries on, and you're left behind. You're not the same.
How has the game changed, do you think, from when you started to how it is now?
Look, the ball in play is a lot more. So I think when I started, it was just under 30 minutes, maybe 28 minutes.
Hmm.
And now it's at least 36 minutes average ball in play. So there's another 8 minutes that have been added on. And some of games that I reffed, I got close to 40 and sometimes over 40. Mm. So in terms of the ball in play, I think you need to be fitter or at least have speed endurance to keep going for longer. But I think more than that is the players and the coaches have become smarter. And so with analysis and superior coaching, they've learned to pick holes in the opponents and work them out.
Yeah.
And in some cases, it's been good because you've got great tries being scored and a great product. And in some cases, it hasn't been good because the defenses have become so superior and on top of the attack that sometimes, and especially in World Cup, you get games where they're quite stodgy outcomes and it becomes a defensive game. Yeah.
What has been your career highlight, do you think? Like favorite game, or best moment.
You know,
Jeannie,
a lot of people ask me that, and I did do 70 test matches, and each one of those is special because every time you run out there, let's say it's Wales versus Ireland, and the ref is from South Africa, you're actually representing your country.
Exactly.
And there's no one else to cover for you. You know, it's not a team where one person makes a mistake, everyone covers for him. If you make a mistake, you're dead in the water.
Yeah.
So there was a huge responsibility, and like I said, I didn't always get it right, but that for me was a big honour. You know, to represent your country.
Yeah.
But I think the Curry Cup games that I did, the finals, I only did six of those, and each one was incredibly special.
Yeah.
It's wonderful to go to a South African venue have a full stadium and see how much it means to, you know, to players who have spent their whole lives waiting for this one opportunity to lift our domestic trophy.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Well, listen, as a friend, you are outstanding, and I think you've made the country immensely proud with your work, so
Thank you.
Should be proud of yourself.
Thank you.
Now, we'll be back with Jonathan after the break to chat more about his beautiful new baby. And don't forget to answer our question for today. Would you carry someone else's child? Why? Or why not? Tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the hashtag Afternoon Express. Comment on our Facebook page or call us live on 083 913 3728. I would carry Matthew McConaughey's child. Over to you, Bonnie.
Coming up after the break, Clem and I are reunited in the kitchen over a one-pot Italian dinner. And I catch up with Ben Getz and we're talking starting your own veggie garden. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. If you've just joined us, Clem and I are about to get started on our one-pot Italian dinner, but courtesy of Sea Harvest.
That's right. So today I'm using the Sea Harvest King Clip fillets. So just to kick off with, we have to have a base of every type of stew. Today the dish is kind of like a stew. It's kind of like a fishy broth stew, perfect for winter. So I've got some onions in there. I'll start to caramelize those. I'm going to go in with some baby marrows.
Okay.
You can just cut those up any way you want to. I really love those. Mm-hmm. Give it a bit of a toss.
I'm really loving this series because all I ever really do with fish is bake it.
Oh, well, nothing wrong with that.
And I'm discovering all these different ways of cooking it.
Yeah. And this is a quick one. And also, what's really great is the fact that I'm using this, the king clip from frozen, which is quite different because normally you get on,
you have to thaw it out,
and you don't do that at all. So I'm going to go from frozen. I'll explain why in a second.
She's just added some chorizo.
Some chorizo. So that beautiful like red oil is going to come out there, starting fusing with the marrows and the onion.
Yeah.
And let's go with the... If you can pass the tomatoes, it'll be really great.
Tomatoes, okay.
You can actually just chuck those all in.
All in. So and you're not chopping them?
Nah, they're going to let the... We can pop open, all the juices come out. All good. So like I said, I'm using the king clip from frozen.
Right.
The reason for that is it's got this natural like sweetness in king clip. And I find that using it from frozen, it actually comes out and it flavors the dish so much.
Wow, I wouldn't have even thought of king clip as a bit sweet.
It is. Yeah. I find it one of the more sweeter like fish that you get. And these are fishes, obviously, not one fish, two fish.
Awesome. Speaking of the awesomeness of fish, Sea Harvest is giving away 10 mystery prizes. Pop over to our Facebook page and copy the link. It'll lead you to the competition.
So also, what's also amazing is the fact that the fish is flash frozen as soon as it's caught. It's like, you know, so there's no like delay in the storing process.
Right.
You know, you're getting a good quality product, and obviously it's sustainable, which is very, very important.
Uh-huh.
So the fish goes in there, fun to do its thing.
And these are quite generous pieces.
They are. You can actually break them up if you want to. I like them quite chunky. This is a meal that feeds four people.
Okay.
So we're keeping it. Everything happens inside the pot as well, inside the pan.
Nice.
So a little bit of the wine goes in.
One pot stop.
And remember the wine actually, the alcohol cooks up. So you deglaze in with the wine.
Fish and wine.
Fish and wine, absolutely.
Okay.
So that's going to start reducing. All the alcohol is going to cook up. Once that happens, I'm going to add my stock. And I'm using chicken stock.
Right.
We don't need to add a seafood stock. Because, I mean, I know at home we all probably have chicken stock. It's quite difficult, like, to go and source good seafood stock. Use chicken. No problem with that at all. Okay. So, obviously, what you got is some garlic and chili. You can add that.
Uh-huh.
Just mix that through. And what happens now is it goes to the oven under the grill for about 20 minutes. So during that time, the fish will cook through and all the tomatoes and zucchini will blister.
And all those flavors will blend.
And you get this.
And this
you see what I mean?
It's going to look like.
Super amazing, super delicious, but it's not done just yet.
And when do we add the potatoes?
The potatoes go in there as well. Yes.
Right, okay.
It's on your far side. The potatoes go in, you pop it in there, and then it goes to the oven.
Okay, perfect.
So we've got our stew over here, and it's done at this point, but I want to add a little bit of more color, a little more flavor, and to that I use just simple basil pesto.
Pesto, okay.
And I just stir it through. There's this French dish called super pesto, which is soup, and then it's got like pesto stirred through at the end. Kind of the inspiration for this dish, and you get those fresh basil flavors.
Right.
And that's the soup done. That's our stew done. Whoa. But obviously, so much sauce. It's so delicious. We have to serve it with a crunchy bread, which you've got on the side over there.
All right. Okay. What have you done to that bread?
That's just garlic bread. I just served it up. Mm-hmm. And when we serve it later, we're just going to serve it with the crunchy bread on the side. So you can scoop up all that sauce and a bit of the fish and all
yummy,
the goodness.
Yummy. Absolutely love it. Pop over to our website, afternoonexpress.co.za, for the full recipe and shopping list. Let's head back to the couch with Jeannie.
Back on the couch with absolute legend, Jonathan Kaplan. Welcome back. So, Jonathan, on the 1st of June this year, You became a father to the beautiful Caleb Eli. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Why did you decide to go the route of a surrogate?
It's just basically circumstantial. So when I was growing up, I think like most people, I thought I would land myself in a comfortable family life. But for one or another reason, so maybe it's my character, maybe it's the work that I was doing. I was on the road for about 2 decades, flying 100 flights a year average, and being out the country for, let's say, between 4 and 7 months. So perhaps that wasn't as attractive as it may appear on paper for the other.
Yeah.
And so for one or another reason, I mean, I had many girlfriends, but I just never settled down. And when I finished my career at the end of 2013, I said to myself that if this one that I was in at that time wasn't going to work, I was going to do it on my own, irrespective of what came my way. Wow. Which is exactly what happened. And the process was 2.5 years in the making.
Wow. What is the process? How does it work?
Okay, so I went to see a girl called Kim from a platform called Nurture. So they are a donor platform, and they facilitate the process. And the process is you go and see them. You have to go through the courts to prevent the surrogate from having attachment to these rights to the baby. You've got to go through psychological testing and some other forms of assessment. You then go to a fertility clinic where they measure you, and then obviously the donor that you choose to see, perhaps if there's a match, I'm not really sure.
Yeah.
And once you've got the court order, then you can start syncing the surrogate with the donor so that when the right time comes, you go in and they make the this thing called a blastocyst. So between the sperm and the donor's eggs, and then that's inserted into the surrogate after a period of 3 to 5 days.
Yeah.
And I had numerous failures along the way. My surrogate was outstanding. I mean, she carried me through the whole process.
Amazing.
She's obviously to me, but maybe not to others, is that she had to have had kids already. So not to make that too difficult for her.
Yeah.
She knew exactly what to do. She knew the process. She helped me, like I said, throughout, and she was an absolute star on the day.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the challenges is what do you do post-event? Mm. And I think she's a wonderful person. I mean, she's given me the greatest gift I've ever had. So
exactly.
I've said to her, look, the door's open. We can have a relationship.
Yeah.
You know, there's no threat to myself or my son.
Exactly.
And without her, you know, he may not have come into existence. So I am forever grateful to
That's so beautiful.
Yeah.
We asked our viewers, would they carry somebody else's child and would they be a surrogate? So Kathy Twix, fun of Estes, and said, I'd not be able to carry someone else's child. The reason being, when you carry a child for 9 months, you bond with that small human being, and I wouldn't be able to let the child go to another family once the baby is born. I'm sure a lot of women feel like that, but I suppose, like you said, that Kim had already had her own family. So then
Kim was the facilitator on the platform.
Okay.
The surrogate is a different lady.
Surrogate.
Yeah.
What would be the motive for a surrogate to be an incubator?
In this particular case, it was pure goodwill. They're not allowed to make one cent out of it.
Yeah.
So I cover her costs.
Yeah.
She worked at the time, so obviously she had to take leave.
Yeah.
She had her 2 kids, so then it was an unpaid leave situation.
Amazing.
But listen, that for me, you know, that's a resource that you have to work out before you start whether you're capable of fulfilling it. But it's exactly the same as time.
Yeah.
You know, time is a resource. You have to work out whether it's not just about having a child and there's your toy and when you come back from work, you've got your toy.
No.
It's about, you know, being a parent to the best of your ability. And so that's my challenge, is really about giving of my time, seeing as I'm the mom and the dad.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But you've also got an amazing support system around you.
I have. I'm very lucky. My mom sold her business in Joburg.
Yeah.
And so she moved down to Cape Town at some stage, and she helps me when I need to get away for work.
Yeah.
And
gorgeous.
I've got friends. Yeah, I've got friends who've been more than willing to help out. I mean, I did offer
to babysit, actually, when I found out. And then I think you responded saying, can I be there when you babysit?
No, I know these, you know, the sort of outfits that you'd wear, and I'm not sure that Caleb would be that impressed as I am. But
Caleb
anyway,
would be impressed.
Yeah.
Okay, then Caleb's also got brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
And we brought Caleb's sister here today. as well.
Yeah, this one, this is patat.
Hi, patat.
I'm not the sister, it's the dog.
Hello, patat.
There you go.
Up. Good girl.
She's so sweet.
Sit.
Now, I'm pretty sure I've begged you for a puppy very many a time.
Sure, I'm glad hey you girl. Said the second part how of that,
that equation. Hey, girl, how gorgeous. Happy, happy family. Now, I want to know, I love to get into the details. When you're selecting the surrogate, is it almost like online dating? Do you get to pick and choose? Is she smart? Does she have a great personality? Does she have blonde hair, blue eyes? Like, what was your pick?
I was really impressed with what she wrote down. I hope that's not coming through on the mic.
Go ahead, girl.
I was really impressed with what she wrote down as a person. You know, that. So obviously it lists her medical specs, her characteristics, and I thought looks-wise she was a good combo, like a good match. But I think more than that is what she wrote down. You know, she had a friend who was in trouble, who couldn't, couldn't have a child for whatever reason, and she decided that she helped the friend, and then she decided to give of herself. So it's it's quite similar to the surrogate who was helping me to give me the gift of life, and so it's the same with a donor. Yeah. And she provided, she's actually provided quite a few
eggs,
offspring. Yeah, no, but not just for me. For you know, she was a successful donor, which made it very important for me because for one or another reason, I was the anomaly. I kept on having failures. I was like, okay.
No, but it happens. I mean, it's like people do that with IVF when they're trying. It happens.
I know.
But it's what a blessing. And you're an outstanding father. I'm so, so happy for you. It really is amazing.
I don't know if I'm outstanding. I just, you know, I'm quite keen. I'm willing.
Yeah.
I'm learning as I go along. Yeah. And, you know, I realize my limitations, and sometimes I get cabin fever after 3 or 4 hours, and I can only imagine what others have to go through if they, you know, in the process for, you know, a day, 2 days, a week, 5 weeks, 10 weeks, you know.
Wonderful.
Hectic.
No, it's awesome. We're going to be chatting to you a little bit later as well. Now, don't forget to answer our question for today. Would you carry someone else's child? Why or why not? Tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the hashtag Afternoon Express. Comment on our Facebook page or call us live 083-913-3728 in the loft with the legend Jonathan Kaplan. We'll be right back. Oh, no, wait, we're going to Danilo.
We will be right back in the next few or so, but what a fascinating interview. I'm just completely taken by Patat. If you want to have a pun on that dog's name, he was on the couch. He's a couch patat, right? Something along those lines. After the break, right here on Afternoon Express, we're going to be taking a look how to create your very own veggie garden. Plus, also, when a home on Afternoon Express hits your screens. And today, we're taking a look at a beautiful home in Rondebosch in Cape Town. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. And speaking about coming back to the show today, Tropica Island of Treasure is back. And are you ready to join South Africa's hottest celebrities in the Seychelles to become a TV star?
You could be joining the show's host, Minnie Dlamini, and games master, Jonathan Boynton-Lee, with the 7 celebrities you could team up with.
They are MT, Jessica Nkosi, Anga Makubalo, Carleen van Jaarsveld, Maurice Page, Zakia Patel, and Siv Ngesi.
You could be part of the 7 smooth teams who will compete on the tropical island of the Seychelles. Each team will strive to outdo one another to stand a chance of winning the 1 million rand grand prize.
Sure. All you have to do is purchase a Tropica and follow the instructions on pack. Go to tropica.co.za and follow the conversation online using hashtag TIOT7.
Talking of sun, spring is on its way, and now is the perfect time to start working on those green fingers. Bonnie has some ideas in our garden.
Welcome to the Fresh Pack Natural Goodness series. As parents, we need reassurance that we're making healthy choices for ourselves and for our families. Fortunately, with the natural goodness of Fresh Pack, you know you're doing just that. Health begins at home, and what better way to make sure we get all the goodness we need by planting our own veggies? And it is an activity the whole family can do together. Joining us today to give us some tips on making our own veggie patch is a garden expert and owner of Urban Harvest, Ben Getz. Welcome to the loft, Ben.
Thank you for having me.
Lovely to have you with us. So Ben, tell us about your Urban Harvest initiative.
So Urban Harvest is a social enterprise which I started 10 years ago. In fact, today we've just finished the installation of our 300th food garden. What we do is we design, install, and maintain organic food gardens. We do this at homes, hotels and restaurants, and then closest to my heart, we do it at community projects. So that would be like creches, community centers, and schools in underprivileged areas. So we set up these gardens that provide food for the beneficiaries, but we're also creating jobs. We have garden champions that are managing the gardens with our support. We have kitchen champions that are getting fresh produce from the gardens, making that into fresh food, and which is fed to the beneficiaries on a daily basis. And then, of course, there's a whole program of upskilling of both the garden champion, the kitchen champion, and also the learners, the young people. And one of the other aspects that I like is that we work a lot with beneficiaries that have, for example, hearing impaired or sight impaired or physically less abled. And we custom design the program to suit the beneficiaries so that everyone gets to benefit not only from the fresh produce, but from the experience of being involved in an organic farm.
What are the benefits of growing your own veggie garden?
There's obviously a lot of benefits. Some of them are more obvious. In this case, you're getting chemical-free, travel-mile-free, and packaging-free food. And it's not just food, it's the freshest food you can have. That's one of our important aspects, is that it's food straight from micro farm to table. So in the case of the community projects, the food is grown, harvested, prepared and fed to hundreds of learners every single day. So then there's, of course, that nutritional benefit, but there's a lot of other benefits, including upskilling. There's the occupational benefit. It's like occupational therapy. In fact, I like this line. I've come across it a few times. It's gardening is cheaper than therapy, and you get tomatoes.
Wow.
So it's really, it's a fun activity.
Yeah.
But one of the aspects that I like best is the aesthetic. So actually bringing beauty into the community is a green space, and a biodiverse space, and a space in which the learners, the students, and also, of course, children and adults can learn.
And for those of us wanting to start our own gardens at home, what are the important things to remember?
The first thing is to find the right spot for the gardens. It needs to get a lot of sun.
Okay.
It also needs to be ideally sheltered from the wind. Another aspect, an important aspect, probably the most important, is to maintain healthy soil, and that's why we use an organic and natural approach, adding of organic soil conditioners, and then always covering the soil with mulch. And then planting, you obviously need to plant seasonally, so the right plants at the right time, and also good companion planting practice. For example, a mix of spinach and cabbage, and even to have some culinary herbs in with your vegetables, because that's one of the natural ways of managing pests.
And how do we make sure that our veggie garden lasts and yields a good harvest?
One of the things is that if your vegetable garden looks good from the start and is well designed from the start and it is in the right position, mm-hmm. you've got a much higher chance of success.
Right.
Then, of course, is your day-to-day maintenance. So there's the basics like weeding, watering, but more importantly, or equally importantly, is feeding. So we can use organic homemade liquid fertilizers, or you can buy liquid fertilizers that are organic. And then just in general, treat your plants with love and care, and be abundant. Whatever you invest in the garden, you get out. And that's one of the things that the students from the schools learn, is you reap what you sow.
Yeah, absolutely. I see the kids like to get involved as well. Why is this a good activity for them to get involved with?
It's absolutely fantastic activity, because they're it's an all-body experience. Mm-hmm. They're actually moving their bodies, they're being active, they're learning new things. In fact, children can do practically every aspect of vegetable garden installation and maintenance. They can be involved in it, and often with a lot more enthusiasm than we might. Of course, the benefits is learning where their food comes from, developing a respect and a love for nature, and then just the sheer enjoyment of harvesting fresh organic produce, yeah. especially in underprivileged communities where the diet is maybe the variety of things people are eating is quite limited. I think it's really important that people learn mm-hmm. About new vegetables, new herbs, and certainly the projects that we run do that for the kitchen champions, the ladies and gentlemen that are preparing food for the learners. But the learners themselves get to harvest fresh yeah. and eat while they're walking through yeah. the garden.
Now, with the veggie patch, we're obviously getting our goodness directly from the ground, but what we drink as well is just as important. What do you recommend we drink, especially for kids?
Well, as you say, keeping hydrated is super important. I mean, here we are drinking rooibos. Rooibos is absolutely fantastic. What I love about it is it's uniquely South African. It's mm-hmm. an indigenous plant. And also what's lovely is that the used tea bags can be opened and you can use the rooibos tea as a mulch and even as a soil conditioner. It's high wow. in antioxidants and the vegetables love it too.
Wow, that's absolutely gross. Thank you so much.
What a pleasure.
Fresh Pack Rooibos is all about choosing the healthy way. With so many delicious flavored options to choose from, like honey, lemon, watermelon and mint, and cranberry and pomegranate. It's so easy to enjoy all the beneficial antioxidants, no caffeine, and of course the natural goodness of Fresh Pack Rooibos. And it's delicious served hot or cold. If you'd like to win a Fresh Pack hamper consisting of a selection of delicious teas, then pick up your phone and SMS the keyword Fresh Pack, your name, and city to 33728 now. SMSs cost R1.50, T's and C's apply, and can be found on afternoonexpress.co.za. Until next week, keep yourself and your family happy, healthy, and enjoying life with the natural goodness of Fresh Pack Rooibos.
Follow three talented young designers as they transform three empty apartments on Valdivia Estate into dream homes using finishes provided by Caesarstone and Plascon. Cast your vote on privateproperty.co.za and stand a chance to win one of the completed apartments worth more than 3 million rand. Sure, what an exciting journey it has been. Welcome back to the show. And just this morning, I was having a really cool conversation with a lady named Omi from Gym who we chat after every single session. She said she's so excited to see who is going to win this competition. Well, Omi, you're going to have to wait until the 26th of August as we broadcast live with all of their contestants here in the loft as we announce that winner. The weeks are really counting down until we give one lucky viewer a brand new home. But when it comes to stunning homes, Cape Town sure knows how to impress. I went to visit a beautiful home located in the leafy suburb of Rondebosch, hosted on privateproperty.co.za and being sold by Rawson Properties. We picked this one as our winner home of the week. When looking to invest in property, one of the greatest value adds is proximity to schools, and Rondebosch in Cape Town has an abundance of these. Today we're taking a look at a beautiful home in this family-friendly neighborhood.
Hi Danilo, welcome to Rondebosch.
Thank
Come
you
inside.
So much. Thank you. Nancy, as I was driving through Rondebosch, this home clearly stands out, but what a beautiful neighborhood.
It is a beautiful neighborhood, and it's in the best part of Rondebosch. We call it the Golden Mile. This is a premier area in Rondebosch. Rondebosch, great for families. You've got fantastic schools in the area, private schools and government schools, and with lots of tradition, lots of academics. UCT is very close, so lots of students. There are hospitals in the area, so we've got lots of doctors in the neighborhood, and people love Rondebosch. We've always got loads and loads of buyers, but unfortunately, never enough properties to sell them.
This home is so big and wide and open. Lots of light flows through here.
I think it's been very well designed. It's taken the maximum advantage of the light. It's got west-facing windows, it's got north-facing windows. It's got a great aspect to the mountain, and obviously the mountain's always very important to us. And then it's got a dome right in the middle of the house, so the light just pours in there.
Sure.
So even on the darkest day, this house is very light.
This home is so beautifully open-planned, it's perfect for entertaining.
Very much so, very open-planned, so you've got great flow out to the garden, you've got flow onto the kitchen. All the sort of utility areas are tucked away. And another great feature of the home is that it's got a heated pool, which has been raised to the ground level. So the open plan extends through from the kitchen to the pool. So you can have great parties, family events, and that's a great feature of the home.
You must also have some of your favorite features in the home. Would you take me through some of them?
I will with pleasure. Come with me.
Cool. Wow, I love this staircase.
Me too.
It's like a grand entrance.
It really is.
Wow.
So So Danilo, this is one of my personal favorites of the home, the pajama lounge. It's lovely and warm and cozy, and they can have TV evenings, eat popcorn together, parents can entertain downstairs while the children are watching TV upstairs. Most of the homes don't have this, so it adds a lot of value to the property.
Whoa, this is my kind of master bedroom.
Isn't it great?
Yeah.
You've got the dressing room, got a huge open plan bathroom. It's got a jacuzzi, which is fantastic after a busy day at work. You come home and you just relax in your jacuzzi bath. It's got a beautiful open plan glass shower. You come into this amazing space of the master bedroom. You've got your mountain views, which are incredible. That's a real selling feature of this home. And then you've got your wonderful sliding doors leading out onto the balcony and your American shutters, which close for complete privacy. Very expensive feature, so they add a lot of value. You can open them to get some light in, and you can open them completely and they slide away to nothing. It means you don't need curtains.
Personally, I've never seen a family home as an investment piece, but a home like this seems like it could be a great investment.
It really is. And when you're looking to expand as a family, you want to consider things like area. You want to make sure that the area that you're going to move into is prestigious and is an increasing area in value. And you want to make sure that you can stay in the area for at least 10 to 15 years, because it's got all the schools. It can go basically from primary school right through to university in an area like this. And that's a very important tip to look for when you are considering moving up as a family. And then obviously you want to make sure that it's got the space that you need. Does it have all the entertainment area that you need? Does it have enough bedrooms? Do the bedrooms have bathrooms? Are there plans for the future? So if you have a grandparent who needs to move in with you, is there a space on the ground floor that she can move into? And so this home offers all of that.
Let's say somebody is looking to live in this home for 10 to 15 years. How well does it work as an investment?
If you've chosen your area correctly in Cape Town, we've had tremendous growth. As year on year, house prices have increased. And even when there's economic turmoil, we find in Cape Town that what happens is that the house prices just level off a little bit, and then they carry on rising again. And then when you sell the home one day, you should really do well if you've chosen the area correctly and if you've chosen the property well.
Well, if you're an expanding family and looking to invest in the beautiful Cape Town, then you can get the details on this home on privateproperty.co.za. There you can also find the dream home and the neighborhood that suits your needs. And while you're on their website, don't forget to vote for your favorite winner home apartment designed by our three design contestants. Remember that one of those dream homes could be yours. We'll be right back. Vote now and you could win a home. One lucky viewer can win one of three completed apartments at the Valdivia Estate, valued at over 3 million rand, by voting for your favorite design contestant's apartment on privateproperty.co.za. Winner Home is proudly brought to you by Private Property in association with Nedbank. Welcome back to Afternoon Express, and this big smile is coming to you just because it's dessert time on Afternoon Express. Today we're trying something super delicious. It's a sort of take on a trifle with a few Mexican flavors, and today we're using the Sasko Quick Treats, the vanilla flavored muffin mix on the show, and we're going to be turning that into something amazing because we want to show you how versatile these products are.
Exactly, but we're going to have to swap sides. I can't do this.
Oh, okay.
Can't do this. Cool. So like you mentioned, we're cooking from the Sasko Quick Treats range, and we're using the vanilla flavored muffin mix today, which we're actually using in a cake.
Yay. What I love about this product, and I'm telling you a personal trade secret here, is I've always been involved with youth and their sort of relationships. And the one thing that parents always forget to do is bake for the school bake sale. You always forget when you have guests coming over, you don't have a dessert. Everyone's like, so what's for dessert? You're like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do? These things are so simple to use and easy to make. So that's why I personally love them.
They really are. And it goes from being a raw batter to a cake mix, to a fully cooked cake in 20 minutes.
Ah. Well, that's simple and easy. And
it
short.
Is, absolutely. So the eggs go in. It's just two free-range eggs. Mm-hmm. And then a cup of milk.
Yummy. That's just obviously to add your moisture.
There we go. And a little bit of oil.
Simple like that. And obviously using any kind of cooking oil which is available to you.
Yeah, cooking oil is exactly what I'm doing. So while I'm busy with this, I'm going to ask you to start the tres leches part of this.
Okay.
The tres leches. Is basically, it's Spanish for
three leches. Leches, three cheeses?
Three leches. Milks.
Okay, cool. So what do I do? Which milk goes in first?
What I've got for you is I've got some condensed milk, some evaporated milk, and some cream.
Evaporated milk. Now, what is evaporated milk?
It's evaporated milk.
How do you do that? How do you evaporate milk?
You kind of slow cook it and it evaporates. Dad.
You don't even know the answer. Like, you just bought it from the shop.
And it's evaporated milk. It's milk that's been evaporated. So it's milk, almost like condensed milk. What's condensed milk? Milk that's been boiled down with sugar to it becomes condensed.
So now you know
milk,
that.
Okay. Slowly cooked milk until it evaporates it for the.
So can I pour this in there?
You're so funny.
Can I combine your dehydrated with your evaporated milk in here?
It's dehydrated cows, right?
Okay.
And they take the dehydrated cows and they get the dehydrated
it, get milk from it. Okay. So all three of my milks have gone in here. They're all three quite nice and thick and condensed milk, obviously adding the sweetness to these different milks that you've got here.
And of course, condensed milk comes from really condensed cows.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, I'm only having this conversation with you. Just put things in a dish. Okay. Can I mix this up?
Okay. The cake batter is going to go in our cake tin that's been really well greased. Mm. That goes in. We're going to pop that into the oven. 20 to 25 minutes later, it's going to be done.
And it comes out like a little base layer of cake-like. Voila!
Like that.
Wow, that is so square. It's amazing.
I know, it's really awesome.
Well, so, rectangle, so don't say that.
Yeah. We got you. Cool. That's really good. Good job. That's that part done. Mm-hmm. What I'm going to do, cut out
I'm going to swap sides with you, Azul, while I mix this up, because it's probably easier for me to mix it this side.
It is. Well, you can come now. I give you permission.
Thank you. So you cut a little piece out?
You cut a little piece out, you take it out like this, you got these little discs. I'm gonna just take two right now.
Yeah, that's okay for now.
I've got one that's done for you, partly done already. I'm gonna give you your one. You just have the end part to finish off. How's that?
I'm just putting my milks on.
There we go.
So I just use a tablespoon like this and just
you can. So that one's already had, it's been fed the tres leches.
Oh.
Which means it gets absorbed by it, but that's been sitting overnight, but you can give it a little more.
Yeah, just a little bit extra little bit of moisture.
Absolutely.
There.
Okay, so what I'm gonna do is go with the base in the bottom of my jar. A little bit of lemon zest.
Oh, wow. So it's going to get that nice citrusy flavor because obviously your cake batter mix. I'm just going to pour it like this. It's probably easier.
You know what? That's so much easier. And I'm going to go with the next one and a little sprinkle. You can go.
More zest on there. Oh, this is looking amazing.
And the next one, and I'm going to give it a little bit of zest.
Is it tres leches because obviously the Mexicans love tequila? Is that why? Because the lemon and tequila isn't the thing that goes there. It's not tequila in here, but
vanilla.
That's the Mexican flavor.
Tres three leches milk. I where does that come in?
I don't even know.
Okay, cool. So what I need now is some cream on the end over there that you've got over there.
Sure, you've whipped this up nicely with some vanilla.
Yeah, like I mentioned that if it sits, it absorbs all of that, becomes beautifully like delicious and soggy and creamy. It's so delicious and some extra cream on top.
Looks so delicious. Yummy. What a recipe to be creating, and I'm sure your taste buds are tingling and you cannot wait to try this delicious recipe for yourself. So go ahead and get cooking, and if you fancy something savory, check out the Sasko website and Facebook page for more delicious recipe ideas. Afternoon and Express, imagine that was our show name. Afternoon Express and Sasko are also giving you the chance to win a Sasko product hamper and a toaster valued at 2,000 Rand. Simply cook a dish using any Sasko product, take a picture of your dish with the Sasko product used and post it onto the Afternoon Express Facebook page along with your name and your creation, and make sure that you name that creation. Make it something super creative if you can. Don't forget the T's and C's do apply. Reference the varying product images in the T's and C's. Now all that's left to do is finish it by putting your little strawberries on, which you've basically done already for me. Super simple, super easy to make, and we've made it for you right here on Afternoon Express. Play around. If I were to create this dessert and call it something, I'd probably call it like a
tres leches cake jar.
But that's what you're calling it. Anyway, don't forget to make your own some delicious dishes and we're with us right here on Afternoon Express. The girls are on standby just to take us to the end of the show.
Well, we actually can't wait to eat those delicious, delicious desserts. Jonathan, thank you so much for coming through and for such an amazing interview.
Pleasure.
I can't wait to see your little man again. And then, of course, to see more of Jonathan's beautiful bulldogs, you can follow Kaplan's Pretties on Instagram. And they are absolutely magnificent dogs. Oh, boy.
Tell me about this gorgeous dessert.
Well, it is super delicious. It's basically a whole bunch of milks thrown into a jar with some really delicious layers of cake. It's absolutely amazing.
It's amazing.
Yeah. Yummy.
So yum.
Okay.
Have a good night, everybody. Good night and happy eating.
Happy eating.
Bye. Coming up tomorrow on Afternoon Express, reach out to renowned designer and illustrator Karabo Papi Moletsane, and beauty blogger Aisha Baker shares some makeup tips on how to achieve a sultry look.
The hottest ad race on TV is Win a Home on Afternoon Express. Proudly brought to you by Private Property in association with Nedbank.
Another feel-good production.